Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this last lecture, I want to talk about theorem proving and interactive theorem proving in particular, the notion of a theory and its axiomatization, and finally I'll say something about piano arithmetic. So let's get started. In theorem proving, there are two main approaches, as you have seen in the previous videos. There is the approach of automated theorem proving, in which you let the machine automatically search for a derivation of true formulas. But in the case of interactive theorem proving, it is the human that constructs a proof. And then the interactive theorem prover, also called a proof assistant, then assists the human user to search such a proof. Now, in this video, we'll focus on interactive theorem proving. So, it is in the case that you use proof assistants, you can also make use of automated techniques. Certain trivial results, for instance, the symmetry of equality, could be automatically proven, but also for certain subclasses of formula, as you have seen in the previous video, automatic techniques can be applied to find a proof. Now, this is useful because then this removes some of the tediousness in finding proofs from the human. But in the case that automatic theorem proving fails, or it in the sense that it does not give a timely result, the human can still steer the proof process towards finding a proof. So that is why interactive theorem proving is useful. So to give you a bit of a background, let's first consider theories and their axiomatization. And then later I'll explain what the interactive theorem provers do. So for simplicity, let's say we work in first order logic. Now, if you have a particular set of formulas in first order logic, you can ask yourself, well, does a particular other formula phi follow from that given set of formulas gamma? So is it the case that phi is a necessary consequence from the formulas in gamma? So we say that phi is a semantic consequence of gamma, written gamma and then this symbol over here, phi. If it is the case that for every possible interpretation I, such that all the formulas in gamma are true in the interpretation I or are satisfied in the interpretation I, then it is also the case that the formula phi is satisfied in that interpretation I. Then we say that phi is a semantic consequence of gamma. And it is here understood that the particular interpretation satisfies a formula. By that we mean that that particular formula is satisfied in every possible state, sigma, in the interpretation I. And implicitly this means that the free variables are implicitly universally quantified, because they can be assigned an arbitrary value in such state. And now in the case that the set of formulas gamma is empty, then we have our original notion of validity of a formula. So that means a formula is valid precisely when for every interpretation I and every state sigma, the formula is satisfied. Okay, so then let's consider the process of theorem proving. Now, if you're given a set of formulas gamma, you can ask yourself the question, is there an algorithm that can generate all its semantic consequences? So we write gamma and then this turnstile symbol phi, if it is indeed the case that phi is eventually generated by such an algorithm. Now, it is the case that we call such an algorithm a proof system or a formal system. And so the description of such algorithms typically involves defining a proof system or a formal system. And the terminology here depends a little bit on the literature. The formal system, the notion of formal system, is the oldest one. So if you have a formal system, then how do you typically describe algorithms to generate these formulas? Well, that involves the generation of derivations or proof trees. And this is much similar to what you have already seen before, for instance, in generating the sentences of a formal language. But now the construction of a proof tree is in a different way written down than the derivation of, say, a sentence in a formal language. And also, you can call this set of formulas gamma the assumptions, and phi you typically call the conclusion. So the assumptions are then formulas that you can use in a proof tree, and the formula phi is the one that is on the bottom of the proof tree that is ultimately derived. Now, there are the meta properties of soundness, which is a property of the algorithm that generates semantic consequences, and we call such an algorithm sound. It has satisfies the property of soundness if it is the case that if from a set of formulas gamma we eventually generate phi, well, then it must also be the case that phi is a semantic consequence of gamma. And then furthermore, there is the property, the meta property of completeness, which is written as if you have that phi is a semantic consequence of gamma, then it must also be the case that phi is eventually generated by the algorithm. Now, if gamma is a finite set, then there are many sound and complete proof systems for first-order logic. And this is an interesting result. I think it's also presented in a previous video. But then you can ask yourself the question, what happens if gamma is infinite? So it is not finite. Well, what if gamma is not finite? Well, then there is a classical result. I'll just highlight it here a bit, hand wavy, but it's a very interesting result to dive into if you're interested, which is called Gödel's incompleteness theorem. And this should be contrasted with Gödel's completeness theorem you saw in a previous video. Gödel's incompleteness theorem states that any proof system, but there are some catches, any proof system that cannot have both soundness and completeness properties. And in that sense, I mean that for any such proof system that is sound, there is an infinite set gamma and a conclusion phi, such that phi is a semantic consequence of gamma, but phi cannot be, that phi is not eventually generated by the proof system. And now, what do I mean by this particular star? What is the catch? Well, the proof system is deriving formulas in a particular expressive language. And this particularity, we'll dive into that later, but there is a minimum necessary amount of things you could say. It's so-called expressivity requirement that certain formulas must be derivable in the first place. Well, what are those expressivity requirements? Well, it should be a proof system in which arithmetic can be done. But I'll leave the details out here, and if you're interested, you can study this in more detail yourself. Okay, so now let's consider what are theories and what are axiomatizations of theories, and why are we interested in that? Well, because that is basically upon which interactive theorem provers are built. So a theory you can think of as a set, say gamma, of formulas that are closed under consequence. So that means that as soon as you have a semantic consequence phi from gamma, then it must be the case that this phi is also within the set of formulas. Now, an axiomatization of a theory is the following. An axiomatization of a theory is a different set, delta, of formulas, such that it is the case that every consequence of delta coincides with whatever is in the theory. But note that the theory itself should be closed under consequence. However, an axiomatization of a theory can contain less. And that is why axiomatizations are interesting, because you could think of them as being sort of the basis of a theory, out of which, if you consider the axiomatization and all its consequences, it then approaches being equal to a particular theory. Now, for an axiomatization, we can say that the formulas in it are called the axioms. And what are the main interests whenever you consider axiomatizations? Well, they are the questions of, are the axioms in an axiomatization independent of each other? And independence here means that a particular axiom is not a semantic consequence of the other axioms. Because if it would be so that a particular axiom is a semantic consequence of the other axioms, well, you could eliminate it because you can consider it to be a consequence. So it is not necessary to put it in, to use it as a basis for generating a theory. Furthermore, you can also ask yourself, well, if you're given an axiomatization, is it the smallest? And now consider, for instance, if you have an axiomatization where one of the axioms is not independent, well, then you can eliminate it and you get a smaller axiomatization. And it is the smallest if there does not exist a smaller axiomatization. And finally, you can ask yourself, well, is there also a finite axiomatization of a particular theory? Okay, so these are general questions you could ask yourself of axiomatizations. Now, I want to give you a particular well-known axiomatization, namely an axiomatization of arithmetic. Now, to understand that, let's consider interpretation as we saw before. An interpretation, it consists of a universe of discourse. It consists of interpretations of the constant symbols, the function symbols, and the relation symbols. Now, you could consider the theory of such an interpretation to be a set of formulas, namely precisely the set of formulas that are satisfied within that interpretation. So that then gives you a particular set of formulas. And it is a theory. Why is it a theory? Because it's not just a set of formulas, but for every consequence of the theory, the result is also in the theory. Well, and that is the case because we already here have that all the consequences, so all the formulas satisfied in the interpretation are element of the theory. And as an example, you could, for instance, take as a signature the natural numbers 0, 1, 2, etc., and operations plus and times. And now take as an interpretation the standard interpretation of arithmetic. So we consider 0, 1, 2, etc. to be the natural numbers, including 0, and the operation plus and times to be interpreted as usual. And so then you can ask yourself, then what is the theory of this standard interpretation? And if we have that theory, is it then possible to axiomatize such theory? Well, and this question can be answered or is answered. and it's considered well known. The axiomatization of arithmetic given by Peano. Okay, so let's dive into this Peano arithmetic, being an axiomatization of arithmetic. So that means it's a set of formula, but we consider it to be an axiomatization, so we don't want to have all the formulas that are true or that are satisfied in the standard interpretation of arithmetic. No, we want to find some smallest axiomatization. But I'll leave those questions about the independence of the axioms and whether this axiomatization is the smallest. I'll leave that out for the video. That's an advanced topic. But let's consider the following axiomatization. So to make it entirely formal, let's consider a first-order language where we have as a signature the constant symbol 0, the function symbols s standing for the successor of a natural number, plus standing for the usual addition and times for the usual multiplication of natural numbers. And now we can introduce abbreviations. The natural number 0 is just the constant symbol, and the natural number 1 is the successor applied to 0. The natural number 2 is the successor applied twice to 0, etc., etc. So then the axioms in Peano arithmetic are the following. The first axiom is that for any element, So for any natural number, you could say, it is the case that 0 is not the successor of that number. So you could imagine, for instance, in taking for x to be 0 itself, well, indeed, it is the case that 0 is not equal to 1. Or you could take 1 as x, and then indeed, it is the case that 0 is not equal to 2, etc. So 0 is not equal to any of the successors. The second axiom of piano arithmetic is the injectivity of the successor function. So that basically says that as soon as you have that, for instance, the successor of x equals the successor of y, then it must also be the case that x and y are equal. The third axiom is that as soon as you perform addition and you add 0 to a particular natural number, you obtain the same natural number. So x plus 0 equals x. And the fourth axiom is that for all x and y, as soon as you have x plus the successor of y, that is equal to the successor of x plus y. And the axioms 5 and 6 are similar, but now they involve the multiplication operation. Namely, x times 0 is equal to 0. If you multiply anything by 0, it's 0. And it is the axiom that if you multiply x by the successor of y, that is the same as x plus x times y. And now for the last axiom, I need to explain you a little bit more. Namely, the last axiom is not an individual axiom. These are particular individual formulas. No, the last axiom in piano arithmetic is actually a scheme. It's a schematic axiom. So that basically means that it is a way to construct an axiom given something. And the thing given is an arbitrary formula in first order logic. So this is the axiom scheme I presented here. So let's say you're given a particular arbitrary first order formula. And this can be a free choice. So any first order formula you can come up with, you can take here. And so for every possible formula that you can come up with in first order logic, there is an axiom associated to it. And so this axiom represents an infinitely amount. This axiom scheme represents an infinite amount of instantiations. And an instantiation is as soon as you take a concrete first order formula to take the place of phi. Well, and in that case, suppose we have phi and then 0. I'll later explain to what this notation means. And we have that for all x, phi of x implies phi of the successor of x. Then it is the case that for all x, phi x holds. So what do I mean by these brackets and a particular term afterwards? Well, by that I mean the replacement of all the free variables of x in phi by the term t. And that is written between the parentheses. So in this case, it is whenever we have this arbitrary formula that we have chosen to instantiate this axiom scheme with, well, as soon as there is an x that occurs in it, we replace it here by 0, the free occurrences of x. And over here, all the free occurrences of x are replaced by x. So here we can just literally put in the formula phi. And over here we replace all the free occurrences of x in phi by the term s of x. And here again we can just put in the formula phi. So I already said so that this axiom scheme for every particular choice of a formula phi results in an instantiation of an axiom. So that means that there are infinitely many axioms here because there are infinitely many first order formula. So it is the case that piano arithmetic has infinitely many axioms. So it is not a finite axiomatization that I present to you here. And the question whether there exists a finite axiomatization of piano arithmetic, I'll leave it for you to figure that out. Now let's see some examples of how to derive the consequences from these axioms. So imagine that we now take these six axioms plus infinitely many axioms that you get from the axiom scheme 7. And now what can we derive from these axioms? Well, I'll show you a number of very simple derivations. Here's the first. Let's consider, for example, the formula for all x, 0 plus x equals x. And 0 plus x equals x is not an axiom, because our axiom we had was for all x, x plus 0 equals x. And here we are considering, well, can we also prove 0 plus x equals x? Well, how can we do that? Well, the first step to do is we can apply the axiom by instantiating the axiom scheme 7. So we can then do that by taking an arbitrary, by giving a concrete formula for phi. And well, which one we take, it is the formula 0 plus x equals x. And from the axiom 7, you see here that in the conclusion you see for all x, phi x. And so since the formula we take phi is 0 plus x equals x, what we obtain is indeed for all x 0 plus x equals x. But for that, it's an implication. So to obtain this actually as a result, we have to prove that the premise of this implication also holds. Because then by the modus ponens rule, we can then obtain the conclusion of the implication. So to do that, have to consider two cases, namely something called the base case. This is the base case over here. And something called the step case. And that is the formula over here in the conjunction. And so in the base case, we take formula phi and substitute x for, in this case, 0. And then now we have 0 plus 0 equals 0, and we have to prove that. Well, we can do that by using axiom 3. Because axiom 3 over here is that for all x, x plus 0 is x. So if we take for x to be 0, then we have 0 plus 0 is 0. And that is precisely what we want to obtain over here. So the base case we can prove by axiom 3. The step case, in the step case, we assume that 0 plus x equals x. And now we have to show that 0 plus s of x, the successor of x, equals the successor of x. And to do that, we can do the following. We know that 0 plus sx is equal to the 0 plus successor of x is equal to the successor of 0 plus x. And this follows from axiom 4. If you go back to axiom 4, you see it here, right? X plus sy is s of x plus y. And so if we take y to be 0, then you have x plus the sorry, if we, yeah, if it's 0. Is that the case? No. If we take x to be 0, if we have 0 plus sy, it is equal to the successor of 0 plus y. So that's what we're doing here, right? 0 plus sx is equal to s 0 plus x. And of course, you here use x, while in the axiom it's y, but that's because it's universally quantified. So it's an instantiation of that universal quantification. Then next, we have an assumption, namely 0 plus sx is equal to sx, and we here have 0 plus x. So what we can do is we can wrap it around with the successor function and we obtain the same equality. Because if we know 0 plus sx equals sx, then we also know that the successor of 0 plus x equals the successor of x. And so this follows from our assumption. But now if we combine the two equations, then we have 0 plus sx equals s of 0 plus x. Well, and this term here is the same as the term over here. So by transitivity of equality, we have 0 plus sx equals sx. And that is precisely what we wanted to show. So that then completes the proof. And so this has then established, indeed, it is the case that 0 plus x equals x. So let's consider another example. Another consequence from the axioms of piano arithmetic. Let's consider, for example, for all x and for all y, the successor of x plus y is equal to the successor of x plus y. And this is in contrast to the axiom 4 we had before, because the axiom 4 states x plus the successor of y is equal to the successor of x plus y. But now here we see we want to prove that you can also have this successor not on the y part, but on the x part. Okay, so to do that we can do the following. We take we again apply the schematic axiom 7, and we do that by instantiating it with a particular phi. And so to choose this phi, we take the formula sy plus x, equals s y plus x, with here within the successor. And you see here that it is almost the same as what we want to prove, but we have swapped the names of x and y. But you can also rename these universal quantifications. So this formula is of course equivalent to wherever we all replace the occurrences of x by y and it simultaneously replace the occurrences of y by x. And considering that our axiom scheme worked on a particular formula phi where we replace x by, we actually replace this x by zero in the base case, and we reason about the step case also with respect to this x. So then to prove that then from this result, for all x, we have sy plus x equals sy plus x. Once we have that, we can also prove the lemma over here. That's a simple equivalent. But to establish this, we have to consider again the base case. Well, and in the base case, we need to show, in the case where x is zero, we need to show that the sy plus zero is equal to sy plus zero. And well, to do that, we do the following. We say that, hey, the successor of y plus zero is equal to the successor of y by axiom 3. Okay. And the successor of y is equal to the successor of y plus zero by also axiom 3. But now axiom 3 here is applied within the successor. And it's also symmetric. So it is the case that y plus 0 is equal to y. Well, because we know y plus 0 is equal to y, we also know y is equal to y plus 0. And as soon as we know that, then we also know that the successor of it must be equal. So that then, if we transitively link up these equalities, we have s y plus 0 is equal to s y plus 0 within. And that is precisely what we wanted to show. Okay, so that is good. And then we can continue with the step case. In the step case, we assume on the one hand that the successor of y plus x is equal to the successor of y plus x. And now we need to show that it is also the case then that the successor of y plus the successor of x is equal to the successor of y plus the successor of x. Okay, and to do that, we do the following. We can say, hey, the successor of y plus the successor of x is equal to the successor of the successor of y plus x. And this follows from axiom 4, because we here have this successor over here that we then put in front and we remove it from the second place. Okay, so this is a basic consequence from axiom 4. Now we also have that the successor of successor y plus x is equal to the successor of y plus x, because here you can see, hey, we have an assumption over here, namely the successor of y plus x is equal to the successor of y plus x. So over here we wrap this around with the successor and then we obtain this equality. And again, by transitivity of, oh no, not yet. We also have the last the last equality, namely the successor of the successor of y plus x is equal to the successor of y plus the successor of x. And this again follows from axiom 4. But now here we apply the axiom 4 on this subterm over here. And so it is basically that we take axiom 4, which is y plus s x is equal to s of y plus x. And we take the symmetric variant of that, so that's why it's reversed over here. And then we append the successor in front of it. Because as soon as you have an equality x equals y, then you also have s of y is equal to s of x. And that holds for arbitrary terms. Okay, so then this by transitivity now, we have s of y plus s of x over here, which is what we wanted to have on the left side. By transitivity, we end up with the successor of y plus the successor of x. And that's what we have over here. So this then establishes indeed our formula over here. So we now have seen two derivations of semantic of a consequence. Now these are not what you see here. This is all very mechanical, right? It's not that we reason here semantically. Now what we're doing here is we reason within some proof system. And I'll later explain to you that proof assistants precisely help you with this process, as you see now appear on this on this slide, to construct these kinds of derivations within proof systems. And I have implicitly made use here of logical rules that are part of a proof system for first order logic. Now let's consider as a last example how to derive consequences in piano arithmetic. Let's consider the following, namely the commutativity of the plus operation. So x plus y equals y plus x. So and we can then see, hey, if we can prove x plus y is y plus x, well then implicitly these variables are universally quantified. So then we can establish our theorem. But how do we prove this? Well, we can apply our axiom scheme. And in applying our axiom scheme, we have to choose the proper formula phi. Well, let's just take this formula here as phi. And then we obtain for all x plus y equals y plus x. And since y here, we don't make any assumption about it. It is also the case that we then have for all y, for all x is x plus y is y plus x. And that is logically equivalent to whatever our theorem is. So to prove this, we have, by applying this schematic axiom, we then have to consider two cases, namely the base case and the step case. Well, in the base case, we replace x by 0, so we have to show that 0 plus y is y plus 0. Well, and we can do that by the following. And we know that 0 plus y is y, because we know that from the first lemma that we have seen. And we know that y is equal to y plus 0 by axiom 3, but it is stated here in reverse. And then by transitivity of equality, we have 0 plus y equals y plus 0. So that established then the base case. And in the step case, we can assume x plus y is y plus x, and then we need to show that the successor of x plus y is equal to y plus the successor of x. Well, to do that, you can know that the successor of x plus y is successor of x plus y. This is established by our second lemma. And then we can argue, hey, we have already an assumption about x and y, namely x plus y is y plus x. So that this also must hold as a subterm within S. So this follows from our assumption over here. And then the last thing to apply, because we're not there yet, is again to apply an axiom 4, namely y plus sx is equal to s of y plus x. And now what we have established at the end by transitivity is equal to what we had at the beginning. So that then establishes indeed that this holds. And that then completes the proof of this theorem. And so what we can now state is it is indeed the case that by making use of some kind of proof system, I have not shown you all the particular details of how this works, but I've informally shown you how the argument goes, you can construct a proof, or you can derive as a consequence this particular formula from the axioms. Okay, so that is demonstrating to you piano arithmetic. It's actually quite interesting to try to prove yourself some example formulas and then try to figure out whether you can find a proof. But let's not go further into this. Let's zoom out a little bit back again and let me talk about proof assistants. So proof assistants, they are computer tools that allow you to that assist you, that allow you to derive consequences from axioms. So proof assistants, you can think of you give it a set of axioms, and then it assists you in constructing proofs of whatever follows or whatever is a consequence from those axioms. And typically you assume, or you don't assume, but you want to have a good argument, the tool, the proof assistant, has to be sound. So that whenever you can derive a consequence from the axioms using your tool, it actually is a semantic consequence. So this property of soundness is very desirable. Otherwise, what are you deriving? You're deriving a particular formula, but if it's not a semantic consequence, then what's the worth of using such a tool? Okay, so we want proof assistants that are sound. Now, by Gödel's incompleteness, we already know that unfortunately, proof assistants proof assistants are not powerful enough to be complete, especially if they have sufficient expressivity, for instance, for expressing piano arithmetic. Now, to explain a little bit more about this incompleteness, try to consider this. If you have a proof system, can you prove within the proof system itself properties about itself? And this is where it becomes more difficult. For instance, this incompleteness is you can also think of it as follows. If you could show that the proof assistant that you're using is not sound, but this is something that you show within the proof assistant, then what's the worth of it? So it's a difficult issue, but in practice, this incompleteness is not encountered a lot. It is typically encountered whenever you state theorems that talk about the correctness of the proof assistant itself when you get into difficulty. Okay. Now, the point of a proof assistant, of using a proof assistant, and why you can use it, for instance, to learn how to formally reason, is that the proof assistant as a computer tool ensures that the produced proofs, so the proofs that you produce using the tool, contain no logical errors. So you have to spell out all the details precisely, and then the computer tool can check that all those details indeed match up, and that you have made use of all the logical rules. That you have made use of the rules of the proof system in a proper way. And this is nice because as a human you sometimes make a mistake, but the computer is unrelenting. It will signal an error whenever it detects something that goes wrong. So then it can help you as a user from avoiding making mistakes in proofs. That's nice. But furthermore, some proof assistants also allow you to apply automated techniques for proving the trivial results. And the trivial results typically are, for instance, reasoning about equality. For instance, we have seen the transitivity of equality. Well, reasoning about such trivial matters can be automated, or certain subclasses of formula can be automatically proven. So, and in these automation techniques, they remove the tediousness of spelling out all the details, and they make the tool more and more usable and user-friendly, so to say. Now, proof assistants are in practice used to formalize large bodies of mathematics, so that you can be sure that whenever you have formal derivations and they are computer checked, that there are no errors made in them. Furthermore, and this is practically very, very relevant, proof assistants are used to verify hardware and software correctness. So that means, for instance, in the logical design of computers, you can imagine your integrated circuits are constructed out of circuit diagrams which implement particular algorithms. And now, if there is an error and you make a chip out of it, then you have to throw away your chip. So how do you make sure that there are no errors in the design of your computer? Well, for that you can use proof assistants, and they are actually used by large companies like Intel. It's actually quite a funny story that there was at some point an Intel processor. There's this famous floating point division error. It means that you basically performed an operation on floating points and then the computer returned an incorrect result. And this was a result. This result was incorrect because the engineers of the chip did not properly validate their design. So an error crept in, and from that moment on, Intel has invested more and more in using formal techniques such as proof assistants in not only validating their designs but also verifying large parts of their design to ensure that there are no errors in there. And this, of course, increases the reliability of computer hardware. But more recently, it becomes more and more interesting to also do formal verification in software. And for instance, Microsoft has been doing this more recently. You might remember that the previous versions of the Windows operating system, whenever you plugged in a device, it would give you a blue screen of death. because some kind of error occurred. Well, this was because of a programming error. And by using the certified driver program, that basically is backed up by using proof assistance, engineers are verifying the correctness of their software using proof assistance. And that then has led to more reliable drivers. And then if you now plug in a device, rarely you will get a blue screen of death on a Windows operating system. So there you can also see the usefulness of it. So some example proof assistance, if you are interested in this field and want to learn more about it, I can give you a few names, but I mean, you could also continue your studies in this direction because it still requires a lot of background. The learning curve is very, very, very steep. So that basically means that you have to put a lot of effort in it if you want to get a little bit of benefit out of it at the start. But only at the end, when you have put in a lot of study and understand how they work, they start to become useful. But I can already give you some names and then you can dive into it if you're interested in it, and maybe this can decide. This help you decide to continue your future studies in this direction. There is the Koch theorem prover developed in France, Indria, and a famous mathematical result that is formalized and proven in it is the four-coloring theorem by Gauthier. It's the following statement that if you have a plane surface, say of a map of the world, say, and then you know that as soon as you have different regions that they're bordering, you want to color the regions so that you can see, hey, this is one region, that's another region. It turns out that in the flat surface you only need four colors to be able to give every region in the flat plane a unique color that differs from its neighboring regions. So it's quite nice that this can be done. It's a very complicated proof. I haven't looked into it myself, but it's a very nice result. Now there is also the Lean theorem prover. It's developed by Microsoft. And in it, different results are made. And maybe one interesting one is talking about the independence of the continuum hypothesis. And this is a particular axiom, you could say, that is used in set theory. And in Lean, people have formalized that this continuum hypothesis is independent from the axioms, the usual axioms of set theory. So that's also a nice result. Then there is Isabel. And Isabel is used, for instance, in formally proving the Kepler conjecture. That's the conjecture is if you walk into a store and you see, for instance, oranges for sale, that you can stack those oranges in a particular way, like cannonballs, that you can put perfectly round spheres in a particular way that is very stable as a pyramid. Now, it turns out that this is the most optimal packing, and that's the conjecture by Kepler, but it is formally proven in Isabel by Hales and others. And also there is a formalization and formal proof of Gödel's incompleteness theorem, the one that we have seen in this presentation as well. So that's also quite nice and deep results can be proven using these proof assistants. And there are many other proof assistants as well. And one particular nice mention I like is MetaMath, because you don't need to install anything to look at it. You can entirely access it from your web browser. And it's basically a formalization of a large part of mathematics. Looks very interesting if you dive into it. It has a very simple structure. So the proof system is very simple. So you can very easily understand how it is built up. And if you then explore, for instance, a more difficult mathematical result, say there are infinitely many primes, then you can look in what are all the axioms needed to establish such a claim, and what are all the intermediary lemmas needed for establishing such a claim. So it is really making mathematical results, formal mathematical results, very accessible. So that's why I really like to mention it here. And finally, if you want to learn more about proof assistants, there is a survey article that basically outlines a number of proof assistants and compares them with respect to features. And it also compares them with respect to these two features I mentioned here. Huh? So it is important to be sure that the produced proofs contain no logical errors. Huh? And a particular approach to that is explained in this survey article. It's called the De Bruijn criterion. And furthermore, it also analyzes all the proof assistance, these and also more, on how much they support automation techniques. And it's called the Poincaré principle, that you can skip over trivial reasoning steps by automating them by the machine. Okay, so that's what I wanted to say. Thank you for watching this video. And in the next video, I will go a little bit more in detail to give you a demonstration of how to derive from scratch in the Koch theorem prover, in the Koch proof assistant, these lemmas that I have shown you in this video, that follow from Peano's axiomatization of arithmetic. So thank you for watching.